2025. I'm available. So someone asked me just a little while ago, they noticed that I'm preaching around different churches and mostly in the west side of our state on Sundays. And they said, do you have a rotation? And I said, yeah, here's the rotation. I can only go where I'm invited. So, man, thank you for inviting me. And I remember this was one of my first churches to be invited to as I began this new role with the Tennessee Baptist Mission Board, the West Tennessee Harvest Field Team Leader, they call me now, after almost 3 decades serving as pastor here in town at Faith Baptist in Bartlett. So it's been a little different, but now as we are into, well deep into our second year and entering our third year, man, I'm just grateful for churches that get it, churches that are a part of the partnership and the network. And it gives me a chance to say thank you, Bartlett Hills, for a lot of things. But let me just say thank you for your generosity and your mission-minded, mission heart in giving through the Golden Offering, our local Tennessee Baptist offering, and then also giving through the cooperative program. Thank you for that. It makes possible for me to do what I do, among many others. And so thank you, thank you, thank you for being a good partner there. But also, one of the things that I want to just remind the church of today, before we read the text, before we get into the message, I was thinking about the legacy of this church family, the Raleigh Baptist, Bartlett Hills Baptist legacy, the footprint in our community, and the impact, and I would just call it the fingerprints of this church through many decades of ministry in this part of Metro Memphis area. Man, what a legacy you guys have. I don't know all the stories. I just know a couple of stories. This church has sent out missionaries and ministers through the years. I know today you have missionary family living over in France that I'm familiar with. And you've got staff folks serving out on the front lines everywhere in great churches. This church, by the way, today, has raised up and sent out 2 of my pastor friends who are absolutely making an impact. I'm just going to mention their names because they're good friends of mine, and don't hold it against me. Cliff Marion at First Baptist Church in Covington, right? He's one of my good friends. And Cliff is doing an outstanding job, one of the great churches in West Tennessee. And then a young man named Drew Murphy. Do you know Drew? Whew! Man, whenever I'm around Drew, my hair's on fire. I'm telling you. He is always on go, and what God's doing there at Fayette Church, Fayette Baptist Church in Somerville, it's amazing. If you haven't driven down that way, down Highway 64, you should go by there and see the facility that's out of the ground, and it's amazing what God's doing there in their Christian school. And I know they are 2 of your favorite sons, but there are many others, many, many others. So Chim, one of my good friends, serving the recreation ministry at Faith Baptist, doing a great job. And I could go on, but I just want to say thank you, Pastor, thank you. You know, someone said this, and I think it's right, that a church really should never be measured by their seating capacity, by how many folks are, you know, in the chairs or in the pews, but rather the best measurement, and certainly a better measurement, is the sending capacity. How many people have launched from here to go out and make a difference in the kingdom? And so I'm here today to say thank you. I want to renew my honorary membership today, if that's okay. I'm afraid if I only come once a year, you might drop me off the roll. So if I could just renew that today, all in favor, say aye. And no, none opposed. Amen. I feel, whew, thank you, Pastor. I'm looking for my honorary offering envelope, too, by the way. I need that. So he said, check this. It's in the mail, right? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, just a couple of thoughts real quickly. I want to remind you today of something that has been a little measure that I've taken recently of my own ministry, pastoring here in this town for almost 30 years, Faith Baptist Bartlett. There were so many times when I focused on the ministry of the church and the mission of the church, but I'm afraid as I look back on those 30 years now, 30 years, we came here, our little family came here in 1994, so 30 years ago, I'm afraid that I didn't give enough, do enough service to the message of the church. And so God has convicted me over these recent weeks as we got through the holidays. I started thinking, you know, one of the ways that I might be able to encourage the church is to just circle back. Every once in a while, we need to be reminded, of course, that we have a mission, we have ministry to do, but what is our message? Can I just tell you something? The church of the Lord Jesus Christ only has one message. It's the gospel message, the good news of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Paul outlines that in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. That's the bare bones that Jesus died on the cross for our sins. According to the scriptures, he was buried and he rose again and was seen of witnesses. All of that is the foundation and the fabric of everything else that we believe and everything else that we share with others. So I just remind you that we're living in a, how do I say this nicely? We're living in a crazy time. Have you, some of you who've been around a little bit, have you ever seen it any more crazy? And you know, just everything seems to be so confusing, especially to the young hearts and the young minds coming up. The message of this world has gone, I think sometimes you folks have lost y'all's mind. Some of the things you embrace, some of the things you believe, some of the things you're teaching in our classrooms. We're talking about college classrooms today just a moment ago about just the nonsense. And even, quite honestly, even in some of the well-intended, you know, I was home on Sunday afternoon watching the Super Bowl a couple weeks ago. And it's where I really saw it prominent that Jesus gets us. Little commercial, the millions of dollars spent on that, which I get it. You know, I don't disagree with the fact that Jesus loves us. He didn't teach us to hate. I know all that. I know the background of where all that came from, and I'm thinking there's some good people involved in that. But can I just tell you this? As Paul Harvey would say, what that little message of Jesus gets us doesn't take us to, it doesn't tell us the rest of the story. How many of you know Jesus gets us, but he doesn't leave us there? He doesn't just meet us and affirm our bad behavior or, you know, accept everything that people want to do. There is a clear teaching in God's Word. The gospel brings about some change to us. And so I want to look at it this morning from a very well-known passage. And if you're already there, let's stand together. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. The Apostle Paul here gives some framework. And then later on in the writing of the book of Romans, man, that whole theology of the gospel is there. The book of Romans is all about the gospel. But here in 2 Corinthians 5, very practical. I've simply called this message the glory of the gospel. Listen to it, beginning in verse number 16. Therefore, from now on, Paul says, we regard no one according to the flesh. Paul basically says this, I don't care where you came from. I don't care how religious you were or are or think you are. I don't care what is your past, what is your brokenness. He said, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, another second, therefore, if anyone, this is a famous verse, if anyone is in Christ, listen to it, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, all things are of God who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That word reconciliation is used several times in this text, and it really means to bring back together things that are broken. Boy, we live in a broken world. Broken relationships, broken lives, shattered. And God is in the business of taking broken things, broken pieces, and putting them back together into masterpieces. Have you known that? He goes on to say in verse 19, that is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us, that is, to the church, the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. Don't you love the word ambassadors? I was a royal ambassador. My little boys grew up in RAs, royal ambassadors. An ambassador is someone who represents the king in a foreign land. Brothers and sisters, we are ambassadors for King Jesus in this fallen and broken world. Listen to it. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. And then this classic, beautiful passage reminding us of the message of the gospel. For he, that is the Father, made him, that is Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. What a message. What a word. Father, thank you in Jesus' name for the privilege to share just in these few moments with my friends here, the family of Bartlett Hills and guests who are joining us. And Father, thank you, Lord, that you've given us clarity. You've given us conviction. You've given us courage. Lord, you've given us a message that's full of compassion, full of hope, full of direction to a world that's lost its way. God, I pray that this morning that every single one of us will be recommitted and renewed in our spirit to be ambassadors and, Lord, to have the message of reconciliation ready on our tongue, ready in our hearts. I pray that for myself, for my friends, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for standing, and while you're being seated, just a couple of quick things. You know, when you look around, we realize the confusion comes from a source. The author of confusion is Satan himself. He started that in the Garden of Eden, right? Hath God said, Eve, that thou shalt not do this or that? Oh, God didn't mean that. God meant this. And so the tactic of the enemy is still the same. He has continued to bring confusion and contempt on everything that God has said in his word. I've said it like this, that our culture is determined to divide us, distract us, and discourage us from fulfilling God's mission in the world. You know, the enemy, he knows that if he can keep us separated through every little thing there is, separated through ethnicity, through language, through skin color, whatever, through socioeconomic, you know, status. The Apostle Paul here says something so profound in that verse that I read, verse 16. He said, first of all, we don't care about none of that. We don't care what's on the outside. We don't care what neighborhood you live in. We don't care what clothes you're wearing. We don't care how much money you got in the bank or what kind of language you speak. Paul said, listen, the nature of the gospel is inclusive for everyone. The gospel is unifying. It brings us all to the foot of the cross. It brings us all down there where level ground is, where we all have this one thing in common. You know what the Bible says? There is none righteous, no, not one. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All of our righteousness is like filthy rags. Listen, we don't have much to brag about. Brothers and sisters, our only hope is in Jesus. And so the unifying, inclusive nature of the gospel is so beautiful. Paul would say it like this, therefore, if any man, if anyone is in Christ. Listen to this. Whenever you see the words anyone, or in the old King James, whosoever, that's a hallelujah moment. Brother Ellie and I were trying not to dance down here on the front row because two big men can hurt somebody, right? We get excited when we're singing about how great thou art. Man, come on. When you start thinking about the fact that, listen to it in famous verses, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, listen to it, that whosoever, anyone, anywhere, no matter what your past is like, whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have everlasting life. One of my favorite little verses in the Bible, Romans chapter 10, verse 13, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Can I just get an amen for being a whosoever today? I'm so glad to be a whosoever. Every once in a while, you hear somebody say something like this, those people are different. It's not, you know, the way, you know, they're not my kind of people or whatever. And I just want to remind you that the Old Testament as well as New Testament gives some really great instruction on the fact that we are to be inclusive in our mindset. In fact, way back when Abram was in covenant contract with the Lord, in Genesis chapter 12, listen to what the Lord said to Abram. Abram, through you shall all the peoples of the earth be blessed. It's an Old Testament concept. The good news of what God was doing, ultimately going to be sending Messiah, sending Christ, was not to be just in a small compartmentalized. Listen, I'm telling you, didn't we used to sing this one of those days back in church? Red and yellow, black and white, all precious in his sight. Jesus loves the children of the world. It's been true since the ages. In Isaiah chapter 55, 700 years before Jesus, God spoke through the prophet Isaiah and said, is anyone thirsty? Come to the water and drink. Are you hungry? Come and buy bread with no price. I mean, the invitation has been open, inclusive, since the foundation of time. Whosoever will, let him come. In the New Testament, there are so many passages. I've already mentioned a couple of them. But one of my favorites is found in the last words that Jesus would say to the seven churches of Asia Minor. After he talked to the church of Ephesus and all those seven churches, he comes to this closing word, and he says this, behold, Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. if any man, if anyone will open the door. Do you hear that inclusive language, that invitation? Can I just remind you of something that you got to think about this once in a while? When Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock," you know what that means? The Lord knows where you live. He knows your name. He has your address on his MapQuest, GPS, you know, Google Maps, whatever. He can get there. He knows where you live. He's already come down your street. He has stepped up on your front porch, and he's knocking on the door of your heart. I am knocking on the door. You know what we need to do, brother? Somebody needs to open the door. If any man will, what? Open the door. It's interesting to me. Interesting to me. That in the last book of the Old Testament, in the book of Malachi, chapter 1, there's this indictment among the people of God for their false religion, bringing God their leftovers, bringing God their lame, their blind. And the Lord just says this in Malachi chapter 1, verse 10. He says this about the temple worship in Malachi's day. He says, why doesn't somebody shut the door of the temple? Stop playing games. Just shut the door. Do you know what the Lord did during Malachi's day? He shut the door for 400 years. No whisper from heaven. No word of prophecy. Crickets for four centuries. Until John the Baptist came out of the wilderness looking like the woolly man, wearing strange clothes, eating strange food, and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." You know, the first word after 400 years of silence was this. John wrote about it in John chapter 1, verse 14, and the word, the message became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father. Can I just remind you, when Jesus now, not in the last book of the Old Testament, but in the last book of the New Testament. So we have Malachi, shut the door. Revelation 3:20, open the door. Can I just tell you, the invitation to open the door still remains. Do you know that? You know, I know that was a letter to the church, but it's also, I think, an encouragement for salvation. Do you know the door of salvation swings on two hinges? The hinge of faith and the hinge of repentance. We put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone. Lord, I'm open to the door. I know there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. I know there's no other way. You're the way, the truth, and the life. So I'm putting my trust in you, Jesus, and I am repenting of my sin. I am turning away from those old things, and I'm moving in your direction. My attitude and my actions, Lord, I'm all yours. I'm all in. And so the inclusive nature of the gospel for anyone, anywhere, at any time is such a beautiful reminder. Sometimes when a pastor or some of our people are inviting their friends to church, we hear little excuses like this. Sometimes people say this, "Oh man, pastor, you don't want me to come down there to Bartlett Hills Baptist Church because I'm afraid if I walked in that room, the roof might fall in." You ever heard somebody say that? I heard them say that, you know, about coming into faith, and I would say this with great, you know, confidence. I would say, let me tell you something, friend. The roof at our church has been tested many, many times. I mean, just look around this rough bunch here today. You know, this roof, I know it's solid steel, but I'm telling you, the grace of God keeps it from falling down, right? Somebody says this, "You have no idea what my life is. My life is such a mess. I'm so far from being a Christian and church people. I would not be welcome there." Oh, listen, I may have shared this before, but one of the things that happened for us at Faith, I stopped actually saying, "We hope you feel welcome here. We want you to feel welcome." We started stop using the welcome word, and we started saying this: "We hope that you feel wanted here, because we not only welcome you, we want you. You are needed. It is necessary that we have friendship, partnership, connections. We need you here." And there are people who say, "Man, you don't know what I've done." And I always thought, yeah, you're right. I don't really need to know the details. But what I want to quickly add to that is this. You have no idea what the Lord has done. He's gone to great lengths to take broken, dirty, messed up people and give them an open door of invitation to have this reconciliation brought back together again. So the unifying, inclusive nature of the gospel, one of the most beautiful moments in the ministry of Jesus, I mean, you just track him. He's always hanging out with sinners. In Luke 15, he got accused of it. He's look at him. He's talking to those sinners. He's eating with them. And I'm just saying, thank you, Jesus, right? I'm glad he still does. In John chapter 4, a moment where Jesus said, hey, guys, to his disciples, I got to go through Samaria, which was a crazy thing to do. No Jewish man ever went through Samaria, but he went through Samaria on a particular day because there was a lady who was coming by that he needed to have a conversation with. You know the story, the woman at the well. Jesus sat down by Jacob's well, and he waited for her the hot part of the day. Here she came down the dusty trail carrying a water pot. She was walking all by herself. And Jesus initiated conversation. He said something like this, ma'am, may I have something to drink? And when Jesus said that, he broke all the protocols, the taboos of the day. In fact, she called him out on it. She said, sir, how is it that you, a Jewish man, would speak to me, a Samaritan woman? We don't do that around here. And you know what? You remember what Jesus said to her? I love this so much. Jesus said, and I paraphrase, ma'am, if you only knew who was asking you for a drink, you would ask of him, and he would give you living water. And dear, you would never thirst again. And boy, that started a conversation and some confrontation and some conviction. In just a minute, she dropped that water pot. She wasn't after that temporary water anymore. She was now the water pot, and she had just gotten filled up with the joy of the living, lasting water of the love of the Lord Jesus. She ran back into Sychar. She said, you got to come and see. Can I just say this? I've noticed this pattern. There's something amazingly wonderful about a new believer. They don't care who knows what. They just know that Jesus changed their life. And they want other people. They want their mama and daddy and their brothers and sisters and their friends and their neighbors and their colleagues and their classmates and their coworkers to come and see. And I think we have to revisit that part of our message from time to time. The fact that we have been given living water, and we know the source, his name is Jesus, and there's some people that you know that are thirsty and hungry, and how are they going to know unless you talk to them and tell them and invite them to come and see Jesus? Man, it was a beautiful moment. The inclusive, unifying nature of the gospel. The second thing I want you to see about the gospel message, the glory of it, is found also in that famous verse, 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 17, where Paul says, therefore, if any man is in Christ. That is one word in the Greek language. That phrase is the favorite word or expression of the Apostle Paul and what it means to be a believer, what it means to be a Christian. In fact, it's what Paul uses that concept, that phrase, all the time. Read about it in his writings in the New Testament. But it goes back to the Old Testament. It goes back to the ark in Noah's day. Do you remember the door on the ark was open for a long time? And Noah was proclaiming the judgment that was coming and the opportunity to get inside the safety. Brothers and sisters, can I tell you something? Jesus is the ark. And the door today is still open. There's an opportunity for people to get inside the safe place, the rescue place. In Exodus chapter 12, during the days of the plagues over Egypt and the Pharaoh's family and all the others were going to experience the death of the firstborn as the death angel passed over Egypt. The only way to be safe was to be in the house under the blood of the Lamb, protected and preserved. Jesus is the Lamb of God. You have to be in a relationship with the Lord Jesus. That's the only way home. That's the only way out of this crazy place. That's the only safe place to be. He is the rock, the fortress. He is the safety of for our salvation. And so we have here this reminder. Do you know that the Christian message, the Christian faith, is totally, completely different and distinct from every other religion in the world? You can Google this later. Check me out. Do the fact check on this. Every other world religion, at its foundation, has this. You've got to do enough good things. You've got to be enough, you know, you've got to jump through enough hoops. And maybe, if you do it right, get it right, maybe they'll let you in. Maybe you'll get to God or become a God or whatever that religion teaches. For instance, Islam, it's the big one. In Islam, talk to a Muslim friend about this. It's all about the scales, the balance of your good deeds and the things that you do wrong. You better hope, 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 hope when you die, the scales are tipped in your favor or you're gone or you're in big trouble. Brothers and sisters, can I tell you about Jesus? 2,000 years ago, praise the Lord, on a hill called Mount Calvary, he took the weight of my sin and yours, all of it. He experienced the wrath of the Father on our behalf. The prophet would say that it pleased the Father to crush the Son. Upon him, all of our iniquities were laid. He took it all. He bore all of it, all of the wrath. He drank that cup the sinfulness of mankind throughout history. I'm going to tell you something. I'm so grateful today that there is an opportunity that we have as messengers and missionaries to say, come to the water and drink. Enter into a relationship where you are in Christ, not in religion. Some people need to hear that. Not in a church necessarily, but in Christ. I love the old hymns. Do you love the old hymns? We were singing some of them today. I love it so much. One of the old hymns says this, oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span. Where was it? At Calvary. Mercy there was great, and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. I want you to see the third theme that comes out of this passage, not only the unifying, inclusive nature of the gospel, not only the relational nature of the gospel being in Christ, but listen to this, the transformational nature of the gospel. If any man is in Christ, guess what happens? Everything changes. Old things pass away. All things become new. All things are of God, he goes on to say. We've been reconciled. We've been given the ministry of reconciliation. Now we're representatives of King Jesus as his ambassadors. I mean, there is a change that happens, and it is a beautiful thing. One of the most beautiful passages where Paul also writes about that is in Ephesians chapter 2 and verses 11 and following. Let me just read this to you. You don't have to turn there. Listen to it. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11. Therefore, remember that you once Gentiles in the flesh. And by the way, unless you're Jewish here today, we have this in common. We're all Gentiles, right? We're outside. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who were called uncircumcision by what is called the, quote, circumcision made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens or strangers from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. That's pretty plain, isn't it? You were an outsider. You couldn't get in as a Gentile. But listen to this. But now, in Christ, Paul's favorite expression, but now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, our shalom, our wholeness, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation. Can I just say something? Anyone, anywhere who calls upon the name of Jesus can be part of the family. And it doesn't matter your past or your pain or your brokenness. Jesus makes all things new. If any man is in Christ, he becomes a new creation. You have a new heart, a new start. Your name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. Hallelujah. Church family, let's not forget who we are. Let's not forget our mission, our ministry, but let's not forget the message, this clarifying, unifying message of the gospel that sets our soul ablaze and gives us our purpose and our reason for existence. Man, my testimony, I know I've shared it with you. I didn't hear anything about the gospel until I was like a grown young teenager. I was 12, 13 years old before I ever heard anything about Jesus. Now, we heard God's name a few times in our house when Dad had been drinking. There was a cuss word usually associated with it. But I didn't know the stories. I didn't go to church. I didn't go to vacation Bible school. We didn't do all that stuff. Grew up in Memphis. Church on every cotton-picking corner. We didn't go. They didn't come to us. I think they knew us. We don't want to go there. That's what they said. I was invited to a little church camp out in Shelby Forest, Millington area. My brother-in-law, Jimmy Nunn, Master Chief Nunn, retired U.S. Navy, put his arm around me on Thursday and said, Dan, wouldn't you like to give your heart to Jesus? He knew I was under conviction. Listen, man, the first time I heard about the grace and goodness of God, I knew it was aimed at me. I was a young preteen, 12, 13 years old, that should have been in prison. I was the kid that your family said, don't play with him. Don't hang out with him. And so, man, I couldn't believe it. God loved me. Jesus died for me. And that if I would put my faith and trust in Christ, that I could be forgiven, that I would have freedom, and I would have a future. Wow. You know what the first thing I wanted to do after all that was settled in my spirit? I wanted to tell my brother, my best friend, my brother Mike. And I told him, and I prayed for him for years. I remember I was a youth minister, Pastor Elliott, down in Orlando, Florida. I was driving to, I remember almost the part on the place on the road where I got the phone call. My brother Mike called, and this is many years later. You know, we're both now adults and with kids, and I witnessed and prayed for my brother Mike. He called me and said, Danny, I needed to tell you what happened today. He said, I just felt like I needed to settle my relationship with Jesus. I was just driving down the road, found a Baptist church. I didn't know them from Adam. I pulled in. The preacher was there. That's a miracle in itself that the preacher was there. Amen. My job, man, I can't find preachers at home nowhere. I don't know what they do. They're out serving Jesus. Amen. He said, I found this pastor, and he talked to me, and I prayed. I trusted Jesus. I almost crashed the car. I was driving down, tears. You know, I just, Mike, man, I've been praying for you. He said, I know you have. You know what's the possibility here today? Somebody's been praying for you, and you're here today. You've been getting up close as you could, but you've never said yes, Jesus. I want to open the door of my heart. I want to say, Lord, I'm all in. I want to put my faith and trust in you. I want to turn away from my old ways. And I also know this. You've been praying for some people. You've got some brothers, sisters, sons and daughters, and maybe now grandchildren. Don't ever give up. Can I just say one lesson I've learned being a pastor in one church for almost 3 decades? You never give up on anybody. Those little mean kids down in children's church, whatever, they're going to shock the fire out of some of you. They're going to turn out to be a respectable young people. If they avoid prison, they're going to get by. It's going to be great. They're going to be leaders of the church, the next generation. Let's don't give up on them. Amen. Pray for them. Teach them. Get after it. So the transformational nature of the gospel. Can I just tell you one last thing real quick? Last time to go, but listen. This part of the message, not only that it's inclusive and unifying, that it's relational, that it's transformational, but I want you to see the supernatural aspect. Because you know what? Quite honestly, the preaching of the gospel has very little to do with a human instrument. God chooses to use whoever he wants to. He's used some pretty sorry rascals through the years. And I'm just talking about me and Brother Elliot in that regard. But, you know, he just uses anybody who will. It's not the messenger, it's the message. Right? Some of you have been reluctant to be teachers. We need you. Because you think you don't, you know, whatever, you don't measure up. Listen, God, again, uses ordinary people through his supernatural Holy Spirit infusion to do amazing things. So don't you say no. It's the time to say yes. And the supernatural aspect of it, listen, that God would use any of us in the process, that God chose to use us in this ministry of reconciliation, that God speaks through us. Paul said, God is pleading with you through us. Paul never got over that. How could he use me? I've done so many horrid things. Well, Paul, it's not about you. It's about the grace of God in you and through you, right? And then there's this. Here's the supernatural. This is the theological term is the soteriological ideology of salvation, of the gospel. Listen to it. That God the Father made him the Son who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we, broken humanity, we sinful people, might become the righteousness of God in him. Hallelujah. Study that, parse that out a little bit for yourself. Memorize verse 21 and study on it a little bit further because it's deep and wide and it goes down to the core of the message of the gospel, and it's supernatural that God would do that. God, what a trade. What an exchange. Our brokenness for his righteousness. Who would want to say yes to a deal like that? And that's the offer. Pastor Elliot gives every week, constantly, relentlessly. Come to Jesus. Put your faith and trust in him. That's the message of the gospel. It's what we have to offer. And I've just learned this. There are people all around us that are just dying to know that God loves them, that the Father loves them. My youngest son, we got three boys. We're proud of all of them. They've given us 7 grandchildren. Amen. You know, here's the deal with us. We had those three boys. They grew up here in Bartlett. And then they promptly gave us 5 grandsons, right? That's 0 for 8 if you're keeping note, you know, keeping count there. But finally, our oldest son got back in the game, and he gave us a little granddaughter. She's almost 5. The most beautiful little girl you've ever seen in your life, Hadley Grace. And then our baby boy, whose story I want to tell you about, Joey, our son Joey, has a little girl named Sadie. She's 2. So I'm not jealous of anybody anymore that has girls. Amen? I'm good. What I've learned, Papa doesn't have enough money anymore. That's all I've learned, so that's the deal. Our middle son, Josh, is a pastor. He's pastoring at First Baptist Church of Milan up in Gibson County. He's in his first year there. They're having a great, great beginning. Our youngest son is at work this morning right around the corner. He is a Bartlett firefighter paramedic at station number 4 and protecting this community. Amen. When Joey, our son Joey is the kindest, gentlest, still to this day. He loves people. God called him into this because he cares about people, wants to help people. And when he was a little boy, I close with this message. When he was a little boy, 5 years old, I remember this because he was in kindergarten, Joey would go around our neighborhood meeting people. I mean, he loved this. Senior adults in the neighborhood, everybody knew Joey. I was Joey's dad. Everybody knew this little boy. He was just friendly, happy, all that. Always, you know, he had free reign in our little neighborhood. And all the children, you know, he'd meet them and bring them over. So he brought over one day this little girl, and her name is Candace. Never will forget Candace. Candace was the most beautiful little girl you've ever seen, brown hair, brown eyes. And they were in class together at Bartlett Elementary in kindergarten. And she was new in the neighborhood. We hadn't seen her much. And we noticed that whenever Candace was coming over, Joey would come in and say, "Can I get some food for Candace? Can I get something to eat for Candace?" Candace was always hungry. And she was always a little disheveled. With all due respect, I just have a few memories of her with her hair not quite combed completely and her clothes a little, you know, maybe mismatched or messy or whatever. And I honestly, you know, we're busy, we're coming and going. I'd see her in the front yard. But on one occasion, I was invited to be the guest reader at Bartlett Elementary School kindergarten class. And so I was, it's like, you know, Cat in the Hat Day or whatever. I'm reading Dr. Seuss book. And, you know, the real test of going to read in a kindergarten class, not only that you got 25 or 30 kindergartens in there, but those little chairs. Man. So it's a test of my faith. I'm sitting down in one of them little chairs, kindergarten chairs. I sit down, and all the kids are on a mat. They're coming as close as they can. And this little girl, this little beautiful brown-haired, brown-eyed girl named Candace, she starts tugging on my pants leg, pulling my pants leg. And she was whispering something. And I said, "Baby, I can't hear you. What are you saying?" And she was saying this. "Can you say my name? Can you say my name?" And I thought, oh my gracious. This little girl wants all of her friends to know that this great big old man, this preacher, knows who she is. So I made a big deal out of it. "Candace, my neighbor, my sweet friend, how are you doing? You look so pretty today." And her eyes lit up and she looked around to be sure everybody saw. And I read Cat in the Hat and I was gone. Wasn't long before we noticed that Candace had disappeared from our neighborhood and from the school. I asked Joey, where's your little friend Candace? He said, "She moved." We found out from the kindergarten teacher, who's a friend of ours, that Candace was in the foster system. Her mother, I think her mother was in prison, honestly. And she was being tossed around to an aunt, an uncle, whatever. And then she got in the foster system and she's gone. My son Joey now is 30, so that was 25 years ago. And I think about that little girl all the time. I think about Candace. She's a grown young woman now. I don't know her story, I don't know where she is. It'd be very difficult to find her, but possibly. But I wonder if Candace ever came to know that the God in heaven, who formed this universe, knows her name. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 1. Listen to it. I'll close with this. Listen. "But now, thus saith the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine." Brothers and sisters, I don't know who needs to hear this today, but somebody needs to hear this. God in heaven knows your name. And he has got a purpose and a plan. You know, every life has a story. Let's don't leave anybody behind. I look back now and think, man, I wish I had time to have rescued that little girl. We would have taken her in our house. We would have adopted that little girl had we known. We just didn't know. We didn't know, but God knows her name. God knows where she is. God knows you. He knows what you need. I'm going to ask you to bow with me right now. Oh, the message, the glory of the gospel. What a privilege we have to share it and declare it, to live it out, to teach it, to tell it, to talk about it to our children and our children's children and our neighbors near and far. And church family, with your head bowed and your eyes closed, I just want to say this. If you're a guest here today at Bartlett Hills at our church, you are not only welcomed, but you are wanted. This would be a great day for you to come, put your membership here. Tell Pastor Elliot, man, I think God wants us to join. We want to be a part of the mission and ministry here. We also want to take the message outside these walls. And again, church family, I want to say thank you for the investment, the influence that you've had for generations. Thank you for what you're doing now, what you're going to do in the future. God's not finished with Bartlett Hills. I think the best days are still down the way. Till Jesus comes, let's get after it. We've got the greatest message in the world, don't we? And it's right here today for you. If you're here today and you've never trusted, put your faith in Jesus. Why don't you say this right now? Lord Jesus, I'm not perfect. My life is a mess. But I believe that you died on the cross for me, and I trust in that. And right now, I give you my heart, my soul, my life. Lord, I want to live for you. I want to love you for the rest of my days. Help me, Lord, to leave here different than when I came in. And if that is your prayer today, why don't you come and tell Pastor, I prayed that prayer. Just come down. He'll know why. Maybe you're here today and you've got somebody on your heart. Maybe you've got a little Candace. Maybe you got a brother like my brother Mike. Maybe you got somebody in your heart. You want to come down to the altar steps and just pray for a moment. Whatever the Lord tells you to do, I'm going to pray. We're going to have an invitation song. Wait on you to respond. And so, Father, this is a great privilege today to offer another opportunity for men and women and boys and girls to come to Jesus. Father, if there's anyone here today who's made that prayer their prayer, Lord, help them to not walk away unsure, unsettled. But God, I pray that there would be a clarity and a courage and confidence, Lord, and they're coming today to say yes to you, Jesus. Others that are coming to maybe join or to pray, Lord, you know. Have your way now as we just spend these next 2 minutes in response to your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity in Jesus' name. Let's stand together and you come right now while we sing. Thank you.
Pray with me, please. Lord, what a great day it's been in your house. And Lord, you knew years ago that Danny was going to be here today, Lord. And you knew, Lord, what was on his heart. And he so plainly spoke to us today, Lord, that it's not the messenger, it's the message that has never changed in over these 2,000 years, Lord. And Lord, we all have had Candaces in our lives. Lord, we have relatives today that we still pray for. Daily, Lord. Ceasingly, Lord. So during this quiet time, I hope that there are people in this room that will continue to pray for those who are lost, even those in your family. And Lord, now we come back to give just a small portion of what you have so bountifully given us, Lord, throughout our lives. Take these offerings, Lord, as we know you will, and bless the giver who gives to those who need. And it's in your precious, precious holy name we pray.
Thank you, Miss Lucy. Man, what a heck of a voice. Awesome. You can hear God singing through her. Thank you again, Brother Danny, for what God laid on your heart. Truly good news. You know, Danny talked about what God's doing here at Bartlett Hills, and I'm really thankful for that and how the best days lay ahead. But I really want to take this moment to really kind of talk about it. Let's go back to about this time in 2018. And most of y'all know it. We were about 6 months away from closing the doors. Especially all our finance people, they know it for sure. And we had lost our youth minister and our pastor. And God sent people like Danny to come and, you know, kind of mind the pulpit while we were looking for a new pastor and so forth. And we were just, you know, not really sure of what was going to happen. After that, I told you guys back that November, I was like, God's got something planned for us. I know it. The best days are ahead. For the last 5 years, the church has finished in the black. And not just financially. God is still using Bartlett Hills to reach the world. Not just this community, but overseas, everywhere. All you who are stayed here, boy, you know, how great is God? We get to share that. Man, you know, God kept us in the foxhole. God was with us. And guess what? The challenges ain't over, right? But we know this. From past experiences, God's going to see us through to his glory. Amen? All right. I didn't mean to get offline on that, but I just really thought that we really needed to hear that, you know? All right, let's go for the, go fight, win, Bartlett for Jesus. I got a story to tell about that too, and then we'll get wrapped up here and get going. We had our copier guy, our Conica Minolta guy, he's a Catholic, he goes to St. Anne's, he goes, I just saw that. Go fight, win, Bartlett for Jesus. Will you send that to me? I'd like to put that up at my church. I was like, heck yeah, I can send it to you. Absolutely. So, man, having an impact all around the world. Absolutely. All right, top five. Here we go. All right, the youth summer camp is coming up. June 10th through the 14th, it looks like. It's called For Fuge. Please see Lisa Gravatt for details. All right, number two. Pickleball Monday and Tuesday, 6:30 to 9. That's usually a busy time up here. All right. Number three, Awana is every Wednesday night at 6 p.m., kids 4 years old through the fifth grade. Number four, Colossians on Wednesday night. Elliot will be back this Wednesday night going through Colossians verse by verse. And number five, please pray for our youth pastor and our worship leader as God puts somebody on our heart to come and fill those roles. Also, one last thing, men's ministry tomorrow, 2:30 at Bartlett High School. We'll be working with the track and field team with the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. Again, you have a chance. We got an opportunity, a heck of an opportunity. We're going to meet at the track at 2:30 to pray and just Just be there for the track and field team. All right? So after that, you guys know the deal. Six high, both sides, because we got to get ready for pickleball on Monday and Tuesday. All right? Let's pray, and then we'll be dismissed. Father God, Lord, we love you. Lord, thank you for bringing us here today. Lord, thank you for Brother Danny's message, for your message that you just sent into his heart. And Father God, we pray that it would affect us in such a way that we would go forward and share Jesus, share that good news with everybody that we come in contact with the Candaces, with the friends and the family in our lives who quite frankly are doomed without you. And Father God, we just pray that you would put the words on our lips and our hearts and just let us share them with the world. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for saving us. And we thank you for building a home for us in heaven. Lord, we lift it up to you, for it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
God bless you and keep you. Make his face shine.